Hello everyone, Reid Duke here. Welcome to a modern video here on ChannelFireball.com. If you're a frequent modern player, you're going to recognize this deck that I have in front of me. This is Urza Tron. And you're joining me in the midst of, you know, one of my big projects for this year is to systematically try out and learn about all of the major decks in modern. And Tron certainly fits that criteria. Its fortunes have kind of risen and fallen frequently in the course of Modern's history, but this is a deck that's been out there. It's always been out there. It probably always will be out there. The game plan is just so simple and effective to assemble the three Tron pieces by turn three or four, and then ramp, straight to cards that cost six, seven, and even more mana, with these Eldrazi and their somewhat uncounterable effects being important in today's metagame. So this is not really a normal deck, not really a normal mana curve. You see, most of the cards either cost one mana or they are game winners all on their own. There's not much middle ground in there. And the idea is going to be to utilize the new London Mulligan rule as well as possible to increase my chances of hitting a fast Tron. So I'm going to run it through a league today, see how it goes. Traditionally, Tron is basically pretty effective against anyone trying to play a fair game of Magic. Sometimes struggles against certain non-interactive combo decks, like an Ad Nauseam or a Storm combo, but you also have good sideboard weapons to combat, you know, the particular types of decks that you expect to face. Let's get to it. Okay, so here's an example of a hand that I think you want to mulligan with Tron. It's a nice mix of lands and spells. I've got my color. I've got Ancient Stirrings to find a Tron piece. But even using Ancient Stirrings to find a Tron piece, I do not have immediate prospects of assembling Tron, and even when I do, these are not the ideal threats to ramp into. You know, maybe if one of these was Karn Liberated, you could convince yourself that, hey, you're gonna get lucky and assemble turn four Tron and have something, but this I'm not really looking at casting until minimum of turn five or six. I'm gonna mulligan. You're gonna find, if you play with this deck, that it's really not a shocker to win a game when you've mulliganed to six, five, or sometimes even four cards, because when you do assemble Tron, it's sort of this like inherent card advantage where you make three lands the equal of seven lands. All right, so here I have a hand that might work. You know, I have Urza's Mine Expedition Map on turn one, and if I draw a Tron piece, then I do have turn three Tron. I don't think I want to gamble that with being on the play. I'm going to try going down to five. And this is more where I want to be. When you actually have to play a basic forest, that means you're not going to have your absolute best draw with the turn three Tron, but that's still fine, especially at five cards. And I think I'm clearly keeping Forest, Mine, Stirrings. I think the main question is, do I want to keep the third Stirrings or do I want to keep one of these payoff cards? I think I'm just going to keep the third Stirrings. Why not? Okay, Urza's Tower seems like a good pick. All right. Okay, so now do I play the map or do I play the stirrings? My inclination is to play. Well, I guess I can play both. Let's start here. And Ugin actually will be perfect here because Tron plus Forest is 8 mana, and this is one of the best comeback cards you can play on the fourth turn of the game. Certainly one of the qualities of this Tron deck is you're often going to be playing from behind by the time you make your first play, because while most other modern decks are focused on really potent cards that cost 1 and 2 mana, Tron is just setting up. So you're really not going to make a relevant play until turn 3. And that's why you need stuff like Wormcoil Engine, Ugin the Spirit Dragon, the Giant Eldrazi's. These are cards that help you come back once you've fallen behind a little bit. Sure, so actually I'm fortunate enough to just draw the power plant naturally, which means I could get with Expedition Map, say, Sanctum of Ugin, I mean, I may just get another Urza's Tower. I could also wait to crack Expedition Map, see what I draw. All right, you're going to Ghost Quarter my Urza's Mine. So be it. All right, reasonable clock. Hopefully there will be no more Ghost Quarters and no Thought Seizes in my future. Let's go ahead and find Urza's Mine. Blast Zone, something. But I think I don't really want to waste a land drop, or I don't really want to trade a land drop is what I should say. Okay, well, at least now I'm resilient to Thoughtseize. It's basically just Ghost Quarter that's going to be relevant disruption here. Inquisition is going to be ineffective. I have been on the opposite side of this matchup many times in my life. It's a very new experience to be playing the Tron side. Oh no, another Ghost Quarter. Lurrus of the Dream Den revealed off top of the library, so not a companion. Well, it will be good, you know, to sort of know my opponent doesn't have Lightning Bolt. This all signs are pointing to this being just a plain black green deck, as opposed to a Jun deck that might have haste creatures and lightning bolts. So I can go to 6. Ugin's going to be on cleanup duty, but if I actually get to play Ugin in -2 or -3, then I'll be in decent shape. Probably just need to fade Thoughtseize here. Okay. I think I'll just leave the Chromatic Star uncracked. I already have the ideal play for this turn, so no need to cycle that. Okay, Ugin, do your thing. Sure, I don't think it can matter whether I do the Chromatic Star end of turn or on my own turn. Okay, with access to 9 mana. Tower, Ballista, Wyrmcoil. I imagine it's Wyrmcoil. I also imagine I should still play Karn. No, Ballista does just win the game really quickly with Ugin's plus. That's fine. Ten mana. I think I'm just gonna exile everything my opponent has. All right, and that's Tron for you. 10 mana against 0. But the real hero here was Ugin the Spirit Dragon, that come from behind potential. Definitely not clear that I would have won that game with just a Karn or a Walking Ballista or something like that. Ugin really is just so great in a matchup like this. All right. So off the sideboard, I think I clearly want Veil of Summer. And then there's a lot of maybes. I do tend to like Relic in these kinds of matchups. Walking Ballista seems pretty strong against the Dark Confidant Hex Drinker deck. So I'm kind of thinking which among these cards do I want? I think I probably just want the heavy hitters. Spatial Contortions wouldn't be that bad, but I have the Walking Ballista in that slot anyway. Rather I think just focus on threat density. Yeah, so this hand is fine. This actually has the potential for turn three Tron as you go Tron piece, star, and then you can crack it on turn two for Ancient Stirrings. So being able to use your green setup cards without having to actually spend a land drop on Forest can be a pretty nice thing. Okay, so option A is I can play Ancient Stirrings. Option B is I can pass with Star into Veil of Summer. Or option C is I can just Ballista the Dark Confidant for one. Of those, I think I like option C. Holding up Veil of Summer is not that appealing because my opponent, I think, clearly didn't have a discard spell on the first turn. And I should have the option to Ancient Stirrings next turn if I need to. Although that would mean I'm not playing Karn. But I do value getting the Dark Confidant off the battlefield. Plus, I might get Ghost Quartered. My opponent mulliganed on the play. So what they would really love to happen is to have play one threat. You know, specifically Dark Confidant's great because it keeps the card advantage flowing. And then have all disruption. So if I can take away that one threat, that's either going to slash their clock or they're going to have to spend another turn playing another creature. And both things are mostly okay for me. Maybe I don't need to use the star yet. Okay, I guess I should really take the tower. Then play tower and pass. And I have this sort of like disguised Veil of Summer if that comes up, that I need it. Treetop Village, sure. Grim Flayer, sure. I wonder about just playing Blast Zone this turn. Could play Karn and plus four. Yeah, that might not be too bad. Karn and plus four. I'm going to crack this just in case I draw Ugin. Chromatic Sphere, so just ignore that for now. Got a swamp. Having drawn the second Karn, I think there were a lot of decent plays available to me, including just -3 on Tarmogoyf, and then if they want to spend their mana activating Treetop Village to kill Karn, like maybe that's okay given how strong my hand is. You want an Assassin's Trophy, my power plant. I guess I Veil of Summer that. And Wyrmcoil, of course, is an ideal draw here. All right, looks like my opponent binned a swamp and then is putting two cards back. Grimflayer can be kind of strange on Magic Online because it weirdly doesn't put the cards on the top of the graveyard. It kind of inserts them in random spots in the graveyard, so you have to really watch to see what happens. But yeah, sure enough, two cards on top. Okay. I think I'll start with Ancient Stirrings. Just take another Karn. Next, I'll filter a mana through the Chromatic Sphere. Okay, now to find out what they stacked on top of their library. They could potentially find both cards by using the Nurturing Peatland, but barring something that exiles the Wyrmcoil engine, I think it's going to be very tough. I'll be back for round two. Hi, welcome back for match number two. Modern Tron. I'm on the draw against an opponent who has revealed Lurrus, so perhaps some kind of red deck, red-black. My hand is acceptable. Two of three Tron pieces plus a cantrip. I think that's setting me up well enough. Plus Walking Ballista and Karn the Great Creator are sort of middle ground threats where I can customize the amount of mana that I dump into them. All right, my opponent is Morgan to 5. All right, my opponent saw this one off the bauble, so let's make sure to play that first. Sure. Kind of like just cashing in the ballista to hit the abbot. Significantly reduce my opponent's clock after they've taken a mulligan. I'm going to do this main phase so that they can't play a couple of instants to save the abbot. All right. Very solid. Even after I've killed one creature, they have three creatures on the battlefield. My life total is still pretty healthy, but I'm going to have to find something relatively fast. Let's play Blast Zone. Lurrus in hand. Okay, do I Blast Zone or do I Karn? Let's take a look at my sideboard. I have Ensnaring Bridge is not going to be great because it's going to be so difficult for me to empty my hand. And yeah, really none of these other cards are looking that effective in a world where I can't assemble Tron. So maybe I just want to play Blast Zone and wait to draw Urza's Tower. Or activate Blast Zone is what I should say. I mean, I guess what else? I can play Karn and minus to get Relic. But I think if I don't find Urza's Tower, I'm not going to live long enough to get the Wyrmcoil Engine. Another abbot. Oh, my opponent certainly shouldn't play that card pre-combat. Not great, not great. Very likely to not survive the turn. Okay. Yeah, no way 2-2 Ballista is enough to save me here. Nope. Great creator seemed pretty weak that game. Sure, try this. My opponent still has Lurrus' companion, so I can be sure of no Blood Moon, no Magus of the Moon, no tricky stuff. And I suppose I'll actually keep this one on the back of Power Plant Star into Ancient Stirrings. Okay. Blast Zone, Chromatic Sphere, Relic, Ugin. I think I'll take Chromatic Sphere. Then I'm going to play the Star. The difference between Sphere and Star is if they destroy your Chromatic Star with something like a Braid or Smash to Smithereens, you still get to draw a card. Whereas with Chromatic Sphere, drawing a card is part of the ability. Subtle difference. So, opponent's probably going to want to take Ancient Stirrings. Sure. Mine, Star, Ballista. At this point, I'm close enough to just start hard casting Thragtusk that I think I'd rather just take Snow Covered Forest. Yeah, these games, I kept hands that had good prospects of finding Tron, but it was not certainty. And I feel, I've been a little unlucky in not being able to assemble Tron by turn four, or potentially not even by turn five in either of these games. Land. Okay. I hope this will be enough for me to survive. Definitely might not be. I'm at an effective nine. Two of these creatures are going to get through, so, double spell makes it pretty easy for me to die. But looks like I dodged a bullet there. Wow, did I cast four Ancient Stirrings this game? So I know there's no Urza's Tower on my bottom 16 cards. Odds are getting better and better. Come on, land. Land or something castable. Wow, unreal. Okay. Even that doesn't seem that effective. Suppose I'll discard one of these Karns. Nearly dead. My opponent could put me to two here with an all-out attack. Come on, a little help here off the top. Mean, I guess it's something. It's pretty miserable. Okay, the question is, do I kill the Lurrus immediately? Or do I leave the Ballista as a blocker? And the answer, I think, thought I should kill Lurrus immediately. Okay. So now I think I should start attacking. So, say for the sake of argument, I attack with both Thragtusks, then I play Wyrmcoil Engine. My opponent can make a big attack. They can kill their own creature that I might block with the Wyrmcoil Engine. So then, if they draw a lightning bolt, I can take 10. All right, let's attack with one Thragtusk. Put him to the test a little bit. This is one of the weirdest Tron games I've ever seen. Just like finally assembled Tron on turn 9 of game 2. But this game is does remain close. If I draw one more thing, I should be in good shape. Fine. Okay, so an all-out attack, I go to 7 from the Kroxa trigger. I block Kroxa and Abbott, and then yeah, I'm dead to a lightning bolt. I am not necessarily dead to the bauble. Interesting. They bobbled me. Then they attacked with everything. So they're going to be dead on my attack back. It seems like they're just gambling that their top card is an instant speed burn spell. Or maybe they saw something on top of my library that they knew they couldn't beat. All right. Well, that wasn't exactly the plan, but it was good enough to advance the next game. So my marginal cards here feel like Veil of Summer and Relic of Progenitus are kind of like, well, Veil of Summer is great if I can ever actually tag a Thoughtseize, but that's somewhat ambitious. Relic is just like pretty marginal either way. Do I want another Ballista? Do I want another Eldrazi Titan, Ugin the Ineffable? I don't think Karn the Great Creator is doing that much for me. I think I'm fine with what I have. Maybe Ballista is good. Maybe I want Ballista over the third relic. All right, this is the turn 3 Tron. Oh, brutal. All right. Wow. Holy cow, that was like, I went from turn three Tron to now I'm passing the turn with one land. I bricked on two draw steps and they had two pretty specific and devastating cards. I guess I'm using this for green. Pretty brutal too. I swapped my third relic for my third ballista, and the relic would have been massively better here. I mean, for one thing, it would have been castable, and for another, it would have kept my opponent off of that Kroxa. So things definitely taking a bad turn here. Just trying to hang on. If I can survive to Ugin and Wyrmcoil Engine, I have a chance. Oh, man. I think I need to gamble on hitting a land. Okay, let's think. If my opponent is Lurrus in hand, so let's say they draw land, play Lurrus, play Abbot, hit a land, I'm getting attacked for 8. Then I hypothetically could win with map into Ugin, but it does require my opponent hitting nothing. If they hit anything to trigger prowess, I'm dead immediately. So alternatively, I could play the Walking Ballista, which could fog Kroxa. I mean, I guess if they find a burn spell, I'm just dead to the burn spell hitting the Ballista. So I think I'm just going to hope that they find nothing. Oh, actually, this doesn't even work because I have to tap two lands to use the map next turn. So I should have done the Ballista. Let's see if I would have hit. No. All right, I'll be back for round three. Hi, welcome back for match number three. This hand I'm going to throw back. I do have that Sphere into Ancient Stirrings, but I'm missing two pieces, as you can see. And I think it's too much of a gamble. It's more reasonable. So we'll keep Tower, Forest, Map. I guess everything but Ballista. Force of Negation, not too bad of an exchange. So it was Uro, but no extra land. Make him have it. I do think the Ulamog, like putting the Ulamog on the stack, will win the game, so I'm happy enough just developing my mana further while my opponent is not putting me under much pressure. All right. Well, if I get to 10 mana, I'll be in good shape. Okay. So just a clean 3-for-1, and then I have the other Ulamog still in the chamber ready to go. Well, I do value having the uncounterable stuff in this matchup. I think Veil of Summer will also be pretty strong off the sideboard. What do I not like? Relic also seems solid. Walking Ballista is surely one of my weaker cards. Wyrmcoil Engine's just okay. I could just keep it like this. Yep, totally fine with this. I'm lacking in uncounterable effects, but at least I can, you know, threaten a Karn at any point that they tap out. And develop my mana for if and when I do draw those Eldrazis. Fine. Okay, so the Karn, I think, should just go after Triome. Well, maybe just go after Field. I could see that being a problem in the very long term. Sure. Ugin says destroy target permanent. That's one or more colors. Go upstairs. These are all now free because of Ugin's ability. The map, interesting. Anything cool to map for right now? I don't think so. So if my opponent finds like Field of Ruin, then I can replace my Tron land with Expedition Map. If I do draw another threat, I can find a Sanctum of Ugin, which would, I think, effectively be game over. I feel like I pretty well have things covered now. Like the Relic means Uro's not going to hit the battlefield. Karn is working on my opponent's mana. The Ugin is going to eventually provide a threat that my opponent will have to worry about. Yep. And my opponent says, GG's. That was a good showing. I'll be back for round number four. Everyone, welcome back to match number four of today's Modern Urza Tron League. Currently 2-1. This round, I'm fortunate enough to win the die roll. And my opening hand is just okay. It looks like this is a highly likely turn four Tron between the Expedition Map and the Sylvan Scrying, which being on the play, that's gonna be good enough for me, especially with Ugin, that excellent come from behind type card in a lot of matchups. All right, we have a ramp mirror match. Gotta figure the die roll is gonna be important here. Unfortunately, this is a matchup where Ugin's gonna be weaker than Karn, so I'm gonna hope to find something that can disrupt my opponent's mana or just close the game quickly, Ugin or Karn. I think, unfortunately, I need to play Snow-Covered Forest here, because if I play the Urza's Tower and then I need to use another land drop on Snow-Covered Forest in order to play Sylvan Scrying later, that's going to set me back to turn 5 for Assembling Tron. So I guess just Snow-Covered Forest and pass is the right move here. I suppose I could have used Sylvan Scrying, which might be slightly better if I draw Ancient Stirrings. However, in general, I'd rather use the Expedition map sooner as opposed to later, because it can get destroyed. Probably not a lot in the main deck of my opponent's deck that can destroy it, but you never know. All right, so I have Tron next turn. My opponent, if they have Castle, Garenbrig, could Titan this turn, hypothetically. Let's take a look at my sideboard. Sundering Titan can be really effective in this matchup, as can Liquid Metal Coating, but it's a little slow. Yikes, the turn 3 Titan. Highly impressive. I actually have a nice turn with 8 mana. I can go Ugin, then play Karn for 2, grab Liquid Metal Coating, and play that for 0 mana, and then Ugin kills the Titan, of course. Handwear Battlements. Gives a creature haste. All right. Okay, so sure, I guess I'll get the battlements. So because of Karn the Great Creator's passive ability, this can't be tapped for mana or used to give haste this turn. All right, they're going to Pact for Dryad, which is going to turn the Valakut on. And if they have Scapeshift, then that's lights out. Or, yeah, just, I guess, 4 lands is 24 damage. Well, I have to say that was just a really good showing from the Titan deck. I don't really have much sideboard for this matchup. I guess I can bring in the Sundering Titan. And then what? Relic is pretty weak. Wyrmcoil is pretty weak. Ugin's pretty weak. Ballista's pretty weak. I guess Wilt is like not that bad to just cycle or destroy a Dryad. Maybe they have Amulet of Vigor also, though I didn't really see any evidence for that. Something like this. Maybe if they get Field of the Dead going, do I want a Spirit Dragon? Think it's okay. I think this is fine. Maybe. Maybe like that. Okay, this hand's even better because I can get turn three Tron here. All right, can't ask for better than this. Yeah, I imagine Karn is the best play here, although I could play Ugin to set up for the Titans coming down a little faster. But let's not overthink it. What do you say? Sure. Okay, so I have access to 9 mana. Yeah, I guess just Karn and Expedition map. I can map for another tower, which I think that's a good play. Well, this was a very nice Urza Tron game. But now this is going to be the tough one, the game where I'm on the draw. If I can get that hand again, I have a solid fighting chance, but my opponent sort of the ball's in their court with them getting to go first. Okay, so what do we have here? We have turn one map. If I want. Or turn one chromatic sphere means that I'll have three draws before I'm potentially missing my second land. Deck doesn't have a lot of lands, so very possible to brick there. And, you know, surely I would lose this matchup immediately if I don't hit my second land. And even if I do, that means I'm spending mana cantripping a chromatic sphere instead of doing the expedition map. I think I should throw this hand back. Now, this is kind of similar. It's a tiny bit better because chromatic sphere into Sylvan Scrying is faster than chromatic sphere into map. It still has that problem of, hey, I'm gambling on my top three cards to find a second land. But now that I'm down to six cards, I think I'd prefer that gamble as opposed to going to five cards. However, this hand also has the problem of not having any of my most effective threats, like Wyrmcoil Engine and Ugin are definitely not as good as either of the Karns or the Eldrazi Titans. So between having a weaker threat and the risk of ruin of not hitting a second land, it's pretty tough. I guess I'll throw it back. And all right, sure. I mean, we're gambling again, but at least I have Karn now. So probably just keeping these five on the left. Yeah, that's fine. All right, I hope I draw land. No, that's not what we needed. Okay, so do I play the map? And then if I draw a Tron piece, I can still have the chance at that perfect turn three Karn. Or do I play the Chromatic Sphere, which guarantees slows me down, but it increases my chances of finding a second land? I think I should probably play the map. Take the high upside route, since I do need something to go right for me to stay in the game. Neither the best nor the worst draw. It's fine. Oh, God. Have mercy. Okay, yeah, this one was more or less hopeless, being on the draw against turn three Acid Moss, turn four Titan. All right, I'll be back for match number five. Okay, welcome back to the fifth and final match with Modern Urza Tron. Currently 2-2, so hoping for a positive record here. But this is not the hand to do it with. Nor is this. So I guess you can expect a lot of mulligans when you pick up Urza Tron, but the good news is this is one of the decks that's most capable of winning when you're down to, you know, 6, 5, sometimes even 4 cards. And that's because of the nature of assembling Tron, you know, turns your 3 lands into the equivalent of 7 lands. So the built-in card advantage there. Man, so I'm down to 5 here. This hand, I guess, is acceptable. I mean, I could keep, like, land, star, sphere, stirrings, and then have a somewhat reasonable chance of assembling a turn 4 Tron. I think it's okay. This hand would be, this would be a pretty good 5 if the Sanctum was a Tron piece, but this is kind of a lame land to play first. Okay, fair enough. Wow, that is absolutely brutal. No land. I mean, after keeping the 5, there's no lands in my additional 7 cards. All right, I guess I'm going to take Ulamog. I don't think I'm going to have time to use an expedition map to set up. So at least Ulamog is a card where if my opponent has a weak draw or if their threats are all, you know, Worm Coils and Ugins as opposed to Karns, then maybe Ulamog can allow me to come back. Actually, Blue Tron is interesting. Okay. All right. Opponent found liquid metal coatings. The idea here is they can start turning my lands into 0/0 creatures with the combination of liquid metal coating and Karn. And yeah, I can't even use Chromatic Sphere. I think I know what I'm beat. Feels like I want Veil of Summer and Wilt in this matchup in favor of Ballista, Worm Coil, and Ugin are my weakest cards. Maybe like so. Relic, pretty bad as well. Ooh, rough luck this match so far. All right, I guess. Could have used the Wilt here. Wow, this is really not going well. Well, definitely gotten to see the high highs and the low lows of playing Tron over the course of this league. And I guess that's a good thing. You know, you want to see everything the deck is capable of, but you tend to win and lose both in kind of spectacular fashion with this deck, where when you assemble Urza Tron quickly and effortlessly and you can get out ahead, deck's basically unbeatable. And then there are other games where you effectively don't cast any relevant spells. And it looks like this match is going to be one of those matches where I just get steamrolled. I guess that stops the opposing liquid metal coating. Target non-creature artifact becomes an artifact creature with power and toughness equal to its converted mana cost. So why don't I plus to kill that chalice? Fair enough. Yeah, don't think I can win at this point because I'm just gonna lose a land every turn and I'm never gonna be able to get any traction. Remember, I can't even activate Chromatic Star, so I'm a ways away from finding anything relevant, and I think this is a game that I'm locked out of, so I'm gonna concede this one. Like I said, you know, we're gonna see both the extremes of playing a deck like Urza Tron. And that's definitely what you sign up for. But I hope you enjoyed the video. And remember, you can always stay tuned to channelfireball.com or our YouTube channel to find more content like this. See you next time.